furnished by its producers, hosts, and sponsors. And with that, we say it is time for the East Ramapo Underground.
Up in the morning and out to school.
Good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on WRCR 1300, soon to be 1700 AM. This is Antonio Luciano with your co-host,
Peggy Hatton. Welcome, everybody.
Welcome, Peggy. It's great to have you on again.
Thank you. It sounds like you guys are having Florida weather up there.
Yes, and the pollen's really bad up here. I've been sneezing like crazy.
Oh, okay. Well, hopefully that will take care of itself quickly. Okay, so shall we start, Tony?
Start? Where okay. Should we start? How about right here? Oh, I don't hear anything.
Okay, no, I don't hear any music.
Okay, let's start again.
Okay.
Larger than life.
We're going to start with the heroes. The first Mega Hero Award goes to heroes Andrew Mandel and Kim Foscue for coordinating the overwhelmingly successful trip to Albany to lobby for the oversight bill. 400 people from all over Rockland County, people of all races, creeds, religions, and ages, united together to support the East Ramapo children. They met with Assembly and Senate people, urging them to support the bill A5355 and S83821. This award is for all of those who accompanied Andrew and Kim to Albany. So this Hero Award is for you. Okay, well, at least the cheers worked. That's good. Okay, second Hero Award goes to the truly unsung heroes in East Ramapo, our teachers. Despite working in a less than optimum conditions and in antiquated schoolrooms with antiquated equipment and books, they strive each and every day to encourage our students to provide a rich learning environment. This Hero Award is for all of the East Ramapo teachers.
And Peggy, I need to interject here.
Yes.
Just to remind people that this week is National Teachers Appreciation Week, May 4th to the 8th. And actually, Tuesday, the 5th, was National Teacher Day. And however, that was never mentioned at the East Ramapo School Board meeting because teachers are an afterthought.
Right. Well, you know, they're just a burden on the tax system. So, you know, we wouldn't expect them to be thankful, but we really are. We have some really, really terrific teachers in East Ramapo, and we remember them fondly, and I still have contact with many of them. So that's for you guys. You do a great job each and every day.
And just to let the teachers know, we will be on the air in the summertime, so they can listen to us on WRCR 1700.
And they can also call in, talk to us.
Yes, we'd like to hear from them.
Absolutely. Okay, on to the third Hero Award, which goes to Michael Bongiorno, former district attorney for Rockland County. Michael gets this award for his eloquent letter to Senator Flanagan describing the inequities that the children of East Ramapo have suffered at the hands of this board. In his open letter to Senator Flanagan, which can be found in the latest edition of Our Town newspaper and on the East Ramapo Underground Facebook page, Mike explains in detail why the oversight bill is necessary. Mike writes, quote, "Flanagan raised concerns that the legislation could set a dangerous precedent. Speaking of precedent, what precedent is being set by allowing thousands of children to be deprived of a quality education?" Unquote. Well said, Mike Bongiorno, and this Hero Award is for you. Okay, so on to those dastardly villains, better known as the Zeros.
I'm a loser. I'm a loser.
The first Zero Award goes to the Three Amigos in the Rockland County Legislature, better known as Weider, Schoenberger, and Soskin. These three desperados went as far as to vote against one of their own, a Democratic appointment to replace Barocco, Richard Diaz. Diaz was expecting to be appointed and was accompanied by his family, who came to witness the happy occasion. Instead, they witnessed Diaz being sucker-punched by these three amigos. They voted against Diaz in retribution for supporting the East Ramapo Oversight Bill. So, Desperados, Weider, Schoenberg, and Soskin, this Zero Award goes to you. And as a side note, we'd like to thank Mr. Diaz for taking that trip to Albany and standing up for what is right and not what is politically expedient. So thank you very much, Mr. Diaz. Okay, on to the next zero. Senator John Flanagan, chairman of the State Senate Education Committee, is hindering the passage of the East Ramapo Oversight Bill. We hope that Flanagan will see the light and take Mike Bongiorno's letter to heart and finally support the oversight bill. The actual precedent that will be set if this bill is not passed is that it will show that New Jersey cares more about its children of color than New York does. New Jersey, for years, has had an oversight bill, and it brings equity to children of color in Lakewood, New Jersey, that live in a similar situation to East Ramapo. Senator Flanagan, we would be so happy to change your zero to a hero if you would only support the bill. But until then, this zero goes to you. Okay, then, and that wraps up our heroes and zeros for the month of May.
Yes, and Peggy, before we go on, and open up the studio lines at 845-362-0013, I would like to make an announcement. The New York Civil Liberties Union, the Lower Hudson Valley chapter, is honoring three local heroes for East Ramapo, and they are presenting Oscar Cohen, Willie Trotman, and Steve White, who are advocates for educational equality in East Ramapo, the Myron Isaacs Community Service Award. And they will be presented that award on Tuesday, June 9th. And there's a reception and a dinner. And anybody who's interested in attending that event can go on to the New York Civil Liberties Union website. It's www.nyclu.org/LHV. And get all but the particulars. But it's really a great honor that they're receiving.
Well deserved also. Since we're talking about Steve White, we should also mention that Steve, along with two other candidates, Charles Pierre and Morales, are running for school board. So we need you to support them on May 19th. And we'll get into that more later on in the show.
Well, I have it on the list. I could just say that unlike other school districts, East Ramapo is unique, and the voters have to realize that the polls are open in East Ramapo from 7 a.m. to 10 p.m. And if you are unsure about where to vote, you can call up the district clerk at 845-577-6015 and find out your polling location. And we'll have all that information on our East Ramapo Underground Facebook site.
Very good.
And our studio lines are open if you wish to call 845-362-0013.
Okay. So, Tony, what do you want to talk about while we're waiting for people to call in?
No, I had mentioned to you, and I heard about the Mike Bongiorno open letter.
Mm-hmm.
And I took out some passages that Mike had put in that are really relevant and they get to the core of the issue. And he talks about the Senate not shirking its responsibilities by raising the lame excuse of setting a supposedly bad precedent.
Right.
And that's really what's going on. I mean, they're hiding behind that fact. And they are shirking the responsibilities. And it's
very true.
And he Further writes, it's the legislator's responsibility and obligation to guarantee a quality education to all the students and to see that precious taxpayer dollars are not squandered, wasted, or stolen. And that's why Greenberg emphasized that while the legislator needed to be provided additional state funding to the district, it was unthinkable that the state would provide more resources without being able to ensure that they would be delivered fairly. And that's why a monitor is so crucially needed in East Ramapo.
Mm-hmm.
But we do have our first caller, so Good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on WRCR 1300.
Tony and Peggy, good morning. Bob Romanowski, how are both of you
Bob,
today?
Good. How are you? We're good.
Very fine. Good, Bob.
I just want to talk to you about the East Ramapo oversight. I was over at the legislature meeting on Tuesday, and I did speak during the public participation how the legislature should pass this the county legislature should pass the resolution in favor of the county oversight bill, but unfortunately they did not do that. Another thing, I don't know if you could possibly do that, no, the East Ramapo School District is in three towns, Havistraw, Clarkstown, and Ramapo. Has anything been done to try to get the town boards of those three towns to pass a memorializing resolution? Would something like that help?
Actually, Andrew Mandel has reached out to all of the towns, and I think that they have all signed on, with the exception of our dubious Christopher St. Lawrence, who has not signed on, or I don't think he's even bothered to return their phone calls or written requests.
Why not?
Well, that's
why not.
That's an excellent question. Like, who's pulling the strings on the supervisor not to get involved in this nationwide issue? What has it become now?
To be silent on it. Because, you know, we all know that Christopher St. Lawrence is beholden to the block for his seat, and that if it were not for them, he would certainly not be there. I think that... thank you for bringing that point up about them not passed. Did they even try to bring it up, Bob?
No, they did not try to bring it up. They knew there wasn't going to be enough votes to pass it. And there's also a Ramapo Town Board meeting coming up next Wednesday on May 13th. Maybe people could come out and, during the public participation, ask Supervisor Sanglons and the Town Board to pass a memorializing resolution for the oversight bill, as this board has passed memorializing resolutions on other issues.
Absolutely. I think that's a great idea. Bob, can you send me the email with that information on it so we can post it and try to get the word out there for people to come to the meeting?
Yes, I will do that.
I appreciate
it. Thank you very much.
Thank you both for the job you're doing
for the children of East Ramapo. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks. And thanks for your continued support and for going to the meeting and reporting back. We appreciate that too, Bob.
Okay. Take care, both of you. And happy Mother's Day to you, Peggy.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thanks, Bob.
Bye. Yeah, that must have been quite the moment in Mr. Diaz's life, going there with the full anticipation of being voted to replace Barocco with his wife and kids there, and then to be voted down by his own people. It's really disgraceful. There's been a lot written about it in the papers, and how they're saying that it looks like the Ramapo machine is really taking over the Democratic Party, and how unfortunate it is. So,
well, unfortunately, I couldn't be there that night, Peggy. As you know, there was a school board meeting.
Right.
And you know, people do claim to see me everywhere, but I can't be in two places at the same time.
Not even you can do that.
You know, so what was... You know, I did talk at the school board meeting, and normally I don't
bother
because, you know, it's falling on deaf ears. But I couldn't resist this time because the whole budget season was a charade where they gave very few details about the budget. And actually, the revenue side of the budget, they only gave projections. Now, if you remember...
Can I just stop you there? For people who aren't familiar with the budget process, can you tell us what pieces of a normal budget there usually are, Tony?
What
information is usually out there?
Well, there's revenues and expenses, just like you would do your household income, what's coming in and what's going out.
Right.
And you would look back not only this current year, but last year, what happened? What did you actually receive?
And spend.
And right. This year, what did you actually budget, and how did it project out, and what you project for next year? That's how you do a budget.
Right.
But for the revenues, they only presented projections. Now, are these projections accurate? You don't know, because there's nothing to compare it to. Unlike 3 years ago, when Dr. Klein projected that there was going to be a $4 million increase in Medicaid reimbursement, that it showed on the budget sheets that they handed out that prior years, the maximum amount that East Ramapo ever had received at that time was $300,000.
So they went from $300,000 to $4 million. That was incorporated into the budget. And it's very key that people understand that we fell way short of that. That is one of the pieces that put East Ramapo into the downward spiral of deficit spending.
Yeah, so you don't know what these projections are based on. There's no historical reference.
Right.
And when Steve Price was on the board, he brought this up to Dr. Klein. How can you project, you know, $4 million when we've only received $300,000 max in prior years? And they finally whittled him down to $2 million. And, of course, that never came to fruition.
Right. Nowhere even close.
You know, so you can build up your revenues and give out projections, which is nice and dandy, but there's nothing substantial to back it up. It's just pie in the sky.
Right.
Now, remember, everybody has to remember that the sale of the schools, which totaled two schools for $10 million, were used to plug a budget hole in this year's budget. So how are they making up $10 million?
I don't know. How are they?
I have no clue. It waits to be seen how they're making out this charade.
Well, and Tony, you did ask them at the meeting, and did you get answers to your questions?
Yes, very flippant answers, and I had put the video up on YouTube. But the most telling thing of why oversight is needed is Walter Packey, the assistant superintendent, made the comment, nobody would be interested in a detailed budget.
One here but us chickens. What a response to give. No one wants to read all of that.
And I
guess he feels as though the taxpayers are not smart enough to understand the budget process, or nor are they interested enough to see where their money is going.
And then he made the lame argument that it would cost money to produce a detailed budget. And I meant mention of the fact that you can make a PDF file and put it up on the website, and it would cost no additional money. And he had to ask, can we do that?
I know.
And
what decade are we in?
I don't know, but I question the competency of people where this information is put out up on the website, and it has been for years, questioning whether they can actually do that.
And isn't Packey also the one that made the infamous $3 million error on the information that went out to the public about the budget?
Well, no, that was the building repair bond vote.
Building repair bond, right.
Right.
Okay.
One of his columns didn't add up. Because
by
I was
$3 million.
Yeah, by $3 million. And they never corrected that.
Right, and didn't catch it. So, unbelievable. That's all I can say. I don't think that would ever, anything like that would go over in any other school district.
Yes, and our studio line is open at 845-362-0013. And we did get a text message. I know how Steve hates these text messages. And it says, good morning, Tony. Can you talk about the absentee ballot issue that came up at the last school board meeting? And we had a candidate who dropped out who submitted petitions. And it reopens the filing period. And the filing period is later. It was actually till yesterday evening at 5 o'clock. So we don't know if anybody submitted new petitions. But it delays the whole process of receiving and getting back absentee ballots. And I think that's...
Oh, wow. And I didn't even think about that. Wow.
Yes, yes. It's a tactic I think is used, and it's to disenfranchise the voters.
Wow.
And
this is the third time that they've used that tactic, isn't it, Tony?
Yes, it is. And I think it's deplorable that this happens, and education law needs to be changed. So this tactic of delaying absentee ballots doesn't happen. And we do have another caller. So good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on soon-to-be WRCR 1700.
That's right. Good morning. But I'm not in that district, but I am in this county. And I see the problem countywide. But, you know, I just saw a nice, review, whatever, story, I'm sorry, on Channel 12 about A Tale of Two Districts. Had you seen that?
Oh, yes, we have.
Mm-hmm. But my question is, it's two districts? I thought it was one. Isn't it one district?
Yes, it is one district.
Right. So it's no, more
I
like
think
a
that,
tug
that
of
was
war.
One area where that report fell down. And, you know, in my own personal opinion, after watching it a few times, people started texting and emailing me and messaging me on Facebook. People are very upset with the way that came out. At first when I saw it, I thought it was very well done as far as the editing went, putting different films in. But what is really missing from that, which is a glaring, glaring error or omission, is that they never spoke about the Clergy for Justice and their role in getting this oversight bill to Albany. And they never spoke about the civil rights complaints and the role that the NAACP has played. And they didn't contact them, I guess, or if they did, they didn't mention it. So I think overall it was disappointing. What did you think of it?
Well, actually, I thought it was good. I thought it came right out. And, like I said, they didn't mention everything, but... And I thought when they said A Tale of Two Districts, it was sort of like saying, hey, it's really one district, but look, it's really being pushed to two districts. You know what I'm saying? Like maybe make you think that that's the way I take it. It's mm-hmm. A Tale of Two Districts, I'm saying two districts. Maybe they're trying to say that it is really one district, but the balance is not even, and they're trying to make it
true.
Two districts. Right. And I feel the same thing in the county. And, you know, all this stuff that's going on with the school district and the county and the community that claims that, you know, they're about the outside world, we're all one country. If you want to have your own world, then have your own everything else. And don't I personally feel it's the opposite. Like that, what was that documentary? The Jew in Rockland?
Yes,
I was totally
yes.
offended by that because, to tell you the truth, I felt like I'm the one who's being pushed and I'm the one who's being discriminated against.
Mm-hmm.
As an American.
Mm-hmm.
As an American. I have all kinds of friends. All kinds of friends.
Absolutely.
But I personally feel, this is my own opinion, I just feel this is not a religion. This is a cult. And they're pushing and pushing and pushing. And the government is allowing it. Why? Because of the numbers? But you know what? It's not fair. Maybe I'm, you know, that's just, like I said, this is my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, I'm on the other side. And they're crying. And we're like, we're being steamrolled in every
yes.
way. So, like I said, that's my opinion. And
well, I was unable to view the News 12 piece because I subscribed to Fios and I couldn't get the link that was sent to me on the computer. So I haven't seen it at all.
Well, Peggy, I thought what they did say was it wasn't like just, you know, oh, yeah, the same old cry. It basically told the truth. And I think it was the superintendent who basically said, look, you know, this is the problem. And he laid it right out there that, you know, we have so many people that are, you know, not in the school that are getting the services. And that's, public schools have to give certain services, whether it be Catholic school or yeshivas or everything else. But then, you know what, there has to be a limit for everyone. I just feel that this certain group, and I don't care what they think, they're not being nice to me. I don't like it, and I don't like to be pushed around, mm-hmm. and I don't like to be paying extra taxes. And,
right.
You know what I'm saying? And it's not,
I do.
Yeah, right. I mean,
I think it's kind of disingenuous, you know, to say that they're the ones that are being preyed upon, because really it's the kids in East Ramapo that have suffered through all the cuts. So I agree with you.
All right, everything is cut out because it's not their agenda of importance.
Right.
But it's, you know, well, anyway, it's just very frustrating. As you can see, I'm very frustrated about it. And I'm not even in that district, but I know people who do work there.
But you know what?
I'm part of the county.
Is connected. You know, whether you're in our district or not, we're so thankful that we have people outside of East Ramapo that are coming to the defense of East Ramapo and to the defense of the children. We really appreciate your interest and your speaking out. It really means the world to us.
It's one county.
Right.
Okay, and it's the United States of America, not another outside world. Have a great weekend.
Thank you.
You too, and happy Mother's Day.
You too.
All right.
Good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on soon-to-be WRCR 1700.
Good morning, Tony. Good morning,
Peggy.
Good morning.
I know you were waiting for this call.
We were.
I know. Okay. I would like to bring up the fact that on the Steve and Meredith show this week, legislator Aaron Weider said that most of the people that attended the trip to Albany were outsiders. And that was not true, because I was a bus captain on one of the buses, and I knew most of the people on my bus, and they were residents of East Ramapo.
Right.
But as far as I'm concerned, this was not important. The important thing was that people throughout Rockland cared about the children of East Ramapo, that they came out in support of the bill. Now, another thing that I was concerned about was the fact that Clarkstown Supervisor Alex Gromack, the Clarkstown trustees Stephanie Hauser and Shirley Lasser, the county legislators Nancy LeHogan, Tony Earle, Annie Paul, they were there. They cared about the children of East Ramapo. But where was Ramapo Town Supervisor Christopher St. Lawrence and the board of Ramapo? They were not there, not one member. The schools of East Ramapo are failing, and the town supervisors and the board members don't care. Something is wrong with that picture, and I hope that people will remember this at election time. The other thing that I would like to mention is that one of the heroes that you talked about this morning, Andrew Mandel, is receiving his doctorate degree in education from Columbia University in 2 weeks.
Good for Andrew.
Yes, and I think that we should really honor him and to thank him for all of the work that he has done. Not only getting his doctorate, but working for the children of East Ramapo. Thank you so much.
He's an alumni, we should mention, that Andrew no longer lives in Rockland County, but he travels across the bridge to come to all of these meetings and do all of this work on behalf of the kids because, as an alumni, he cares about the community. And so, bravo to Andrew, and congratulations on his doctorate.
Yeah,
that's right.
Andrew still, his parents still live in East Ramapo.
Yes, they do.
Yes, they do.
And they come to the board meetings.
Right. You just got to love those Chestnut Ridge people, don't you, Tony?
They are just wonderful.
We are wonderful in Chestnut Ridge.
Okay, and thank you, and Peggy,
have a wonderful Mother's Day.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
And good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on soon-to-be WRCR 1700 AM.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Junior Commander.
Good morning. Yes, it is. It is I.
Good to hear you again.
I would love to just weigh in here. I, too, given the background, we don't need to go with here. I think Ed Day from the county executive with the interfaith, I think it was horrendous, that video. Your caller previous to the captain that went on the bus, the unfortunate that we are divided. It looks it looks that it was. I agree with you, Peggy. I thought News 12 should have done something really about Newt in a deeper depth. Mm-hmm. There is that problem. I think it's a tale of two different districts doing the other part.
Mm-hmm.
The three amigos on the legislature, Ramapo always controlled it. It had a history of doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Even Aaron Weider mentioned that maybe we should do with the budgets, we should put a controller or a monitor oversight on government. I don't think it's a bad idea of what is happening with Shelley Silver, Dean Scalzo, that has the corridor of corruption that has come through, that comes through traveling from Brooklyn up the 87 corridor, stops over in Rockland, up to Ulster, Dutchess, Sullivan, Orange, and then takes the express lane all the way up to Albany.
Yep.
The monitor and what we see here that is going into the East Ramapo School affects everything. One has to wonder that they don't communicate. And the previous caller, I can't apologize for everyone, but everybody feels, and you see it, being shoved. Using things that you believe in your religion that says you can't use internet, use the tools, etc., it seems to put in for some on others to make those statements that painting us a brush. I mean, I'm a first-generation survivor of Holocaust. There is no way in this community that I ever feel. Is there anti-Semite? Yeah. Is there people that make you feel comfortable? Yeah. But, or I should say yes, that's what happens. But that is not happening here. Nobody wants to talk. To put that dialogue and use the anti-Semitism card or the Nazi card is just the same as your anti-black, anti-this, anti-that.
Right.
And when you have kids and you're taking away certain things, I mean, it's mind-boggling to me that you're taking music, you're taking art and culture, and then you're going to say on one side, there has never been a dialogue. And Ed Day is putting this interface together just to combat this dialogue. And to say nobody wants to, I mean, Cassandra Edwards is a tireless, tireless worker. And she don't care black, white, Jewish or not. She experienced it with her children at Suffern High School when a basketball team in the visiting locker went ahead and put two hanging nooses or one hanging noose. That was meant for the Spring Valley kids.
Right.
So these issues that when you say it's not just an East Ramapo, it affects everybody. And yes, mm-hmm. do we make misconceptions? Do we all do this? Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
But because you are elected official, you're elected official in two areas. One is you got to do the best thing for the entire Rockland County, not just for your district as well, even though that's who voted you in, but to do someone, Mr. Ruben Diaz, because maybe he went on and is able to speak his mind.
Yep.
Whether you agree or disagree philosophically or whatever, to deny him, because you know usually the Democratic Party does everything when you get up there and do it. I mean, it's funny. Because I had to speak at the legislature almost 7 years ago when they want to go ahead and appoint who's now the Spring Valley mayor. And I did it because of his anti-Semitic diatribe. That makes sense when you go against one on your own. Mr. Diaz is fighting for the children. You and I are old in the sense of we've done and we either made our mistakes or we were educated. But these kids are our future. And what boggles the mind with that report, when you said, can I do this? This is supposed to be open communication. And if you don't want to spend the reports, and someone can have the audacity of telling you, nobody has bothered to read the report, that means you're hiding something. Putting on a PDF on that is done every day.
Yep.
And to call and to insinuate nobody is bothering you may not be the same level that what was said to you outside a meeting by a respected lawyer, allegedly, is just the same thing in different words.
Yep,
and people, and the frustration in doing it, look, there is an issue, you put it on the table. Supervisor and those town board go to the block, and that brings to the last part. just because you say vote against the block, that's against any block, whether it's UFT, whether it's the firemen, whether it's the policemen. People have a right to vote, but don't go ahead and use the card and saying, well, now it becomes anti-this or anti-that. I don't think that is fair. I wish people would be more open-minded, but mm-hmm. these are the things that the county executive is going to do. I'm confident with what the people he has signed up. It's a who's who in the interfaith, and that's mm-hmm. the same comment, which I'll close. I really, truly wish Tara Rosenblum on News 12 would at least show that side of the coalition and got that part. That
yeah, that was big, I think, really big to leave out.
It's more than big. It's huge because it brings people together from a religious point of view. Because most of the people, whether you have subscribed to it or not, is a religious community. Whether you're ultra-Orthodox, Orthodox,
right.
whether you're Baptist, Muslim, Christian, gospel, all that. It's all taking that, and they're all religious people. And that video, whether it was Aaron Weedle's voice or not, that production, in my opinion only, should never, these three amigos should not be allowed to have a voice. They should be squashed as a bug as they are. I leave
yes,
it at
I
that.
Agree.
Have a
I
great
agree.
Weekend.
And thank you, you too.
Thank you, Junior Commander, for calling with those profound statements. And we have another caller, so good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on WRCR, soon to be 1700 AM.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And I'm Jeff from New City.
Hi,
I'm
Jeff.
Not politically astute like most of your listeners that call in, so I'm totally confused here why this East Ramapo district has so many problems. Some woman said something about there was a cult operating there or something. I don't know what that would, I don't know what she was trying to say. Could you, in a nutshell, tell me why you in this district have so many problems, and is this universal around this county, around the state, or just unique to this one district?
Well, I'll give it to you in a nutshell. People
That's
are under the false premise that elected officials are doing the right thing for their constituents. And when you don't take an active role in your government body can be hijacked with people who have nefarious motives behind them.
When you say nefarious motives, now what are you alluding to? Some type of conspiracy or something?
Well, in East Ramapo, funds are diverted from the public school community to the private school community.
Contracts, when you say private school, who are you talking about?
The yeshiva community.
Oh, say yeshiva, because
yeah.
private school to me is like maybe a country school. So,
no.
You know, okay, so you're saying yeshivas, okay. Now, is this
and that's a broad
legal
term.
Or illegal?
They circumvent the law. They have no bid contracts. They write up proposals that only would be able to be fulfilled by one group of people.
And so, who's that group?
The yeshiva community and people
okay,
who
so are they entitled to anything? I mean, do they pay taxes?
Yeah, they pay taxes.
Of course they are, sure.
Okay,
and
so
they're entitled to services, but...
So you're trying to say they're like Philadelphia lawyers? Is that what you're trying to say?
The what?
Like
Philadelphia
like
lawyers.
Philadelphia lawyers, like they look for little nuances in the law. Like I don't know how old you are. I'm 75, all right?
I'm a lot younger than you. I'm only 58.
Okay, right. So when I was younger, because my wife won't let me do it anymore, I used to do a lot of drag racing, all right? So we go to the drag strip, right, and we had what was known as hot rod lawyers, all right? You try to circumvent the rules, you know? So is that what we're talking about here?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So
and probably even more than that, because they sell schools illegally, and, you know.
Wait a minute, they build schools illegally?
Yeah. In our opinion, in my opinion, they do.
Someone must give them a C of O, right?
Right, but it's all interconnected with the town and what's going on with the
right.
planning and zoning boards in the town.
But you voted, but people have voted in these politicians that have changed these rules. I mean, it's not like they just blatantly go and say, we're going to take this money, whether it's legal or not. I guess they're taking it illegally.
Well, but it happens over time, Jeff. It doesn't, you know, it doesn't happen overnight that this happens.
Couldn't the electorate, you know, get together in mass and put in people that would be, like, more favorable to the electorate so you people wouldn't have this problem? You're saying, to me, it looks like this problem will go on till the end of time. It's not going to be resolved so easily. Evidently, this cult group, as one person referred to, is moving all over the place. I don't know if the end goal is to have all of Rockland County, you know, be Hasidim. I don't know. Maybe it is. I don't know. Maybe I'm missing something here, right? No one has come to my door to buy my house, but you know, I'm waiting, right?
Well, when you come ask for more than one suitcase.
People calling up. I mean, you know, I would if I came from Mars, I wouldn't know what's going on here. It sounds crazy. So do the children or the parents of the children in the school bear any responsibility for the ineptness or whatever's going on? No, it's basically what... Are you trying to say that the children don't get enough of the proper services and education, that they're ready to go out in the world and assume their responsibility or do the kids really give a... I don't know.
Well, I think that the kids are not graduating, and they're not getting a decent education. So to answer that question, no, they're not ready to go out into the world. They're ready to become, you know, laborers and in very low-paying jobs.
Laborers? What's wrong with being a laborer? I have people working for me that are laborers. They do fine. I mean, I don't know.
Well, it depends on whether you're a union laborer or off-the-books laborer working for a licensed contractor.
Yeah, less than minimum
wage. Do some kids even think about working? I don't know. We employ a lot of people in my place, and everyone seems to work hard, so they get paid well. And I don't know if you call being in the emergency medical service a laborer job. I mean, you have to pass state tests and be qualified and be certified. So, I mean, I don't know.
Well,
we have a lot of people that work there that have had a rough life, and the state has sponsored them, and they go on, become certified, and they move on to different positions, and they work. I mean, that's only what I know from. I don't know from anything else.
Well, Jeff,
I mean,
have you ever ridden around Route 59 in Ramapo during the morning when you see all these people shaping up on the street corners, that it looks like a third world country? Have you seen that, Jeff?
I go. Like this. My business is in the Bronx. I go four days a week. I know what's going on. I'm in the inner city. I'm in Brooklyn. I'm in Queens.
Okay.
I'm in Long Island City. I mean, I'm all over the place all day.
Well, whenever you get the chance, take a ride along 59 in Spring Valley.
What? Are those former students or what?
No. These
right, well, so yeah, they some are young guys. Yeah.
I'm interested in you. You guys allow the military recruiters into the school?
Well, Jeff, we have another two more callers. So we'd like to thank you for calling because we have
thank
to move
you.
On to the next call. Hey, good morning to the East Ramapo Underground and WRCR, soon to be 1700 AM.
Good morning. Hello, Maya.
Hi, Sally.
Hi. Nice to hear you guys this morning. I usually don't catch your program lately. I've been taking some courses on. I'm not home. I just wanted to tell the gentleman who called earlier that, to me, the simplest way of summing it up is that people ran and got elected to the school board only to get their hands on the money, not because they're interested in the children or they're interested in education in Ramapo. And this is an unusual situation. Most counties in the state of New York, people run for the school board because their kids are in the schools, because they live in the community and they care about the quality education in their local area. But if these people got themselves elected under false pretenses, and we can't get rid of them now because the people who voted them in are so numerous. And they're controlling the money, and they're disadvantaging the children that the school system exists for.
Right.
So that's what I would say to the gentleman who just called. One of the things about the cries of anti-Semitism that I want to comment on is that most of us know that it's a red herring. They cry anti-Semitism in order to deflect attention from what they're doing. That there's no real, there's no significant anti-Semitism going on here. The thing about using the word, though, is that it has no impact on me. If someone calls me an anti-Semite or someone makes these charges, it has no impact on me whatsoever. But to Jewish people, it's a terrible, terrible word.
Right.
It's painful.
Right.
It's painful to hear it used, and the thought that this might be happening, that this might be true, is emotionally stressful, and
yes.
it's a cruel word to use callously. And when I think that that these people are using it in a callous way, it has no significance to me whatsoever. You could call
well,
it me.
It diminishes the meaning of the word. Really, that's what it does.
Well, it does in the long run. It's like the boy who cried wolf.
Mm-hmm.
But there are people in our community for whom it's like a knife in the heart.
Right.
That's like the N word.
Right.
It's a terrible thing to say.
Yes.
Now it doesn't have any impact on me whatsoever. I mean, you could use all kinds of words. And okay, fine. I'll just blow it off because I know it's meaningless. It's being used in an out of context situation. But to Jewish people, it's cruel.
I totally agree.
And I would hold their feet to the flames in terms of using language in this way, in this manner. I think it's dreadful. I think it's just dreadful.
Well, hopefully Ed Day's meeting will help to take care of that and at least make a start to having more understanding. You know, you have to understand the people that video was made for. They don't have access to media the way that we do. So when they're told that this big, bad, awful anti-Semitism is out there and that, you know, they're going to be attacked or, you know, whatever, they have no one to tell them that it's not true. So that's also very important to keep out there. And the other thing is that we've gotten numerous emails and calls from people in the Orthodox community that were very, very offended by that video. So it's not just the secular community, but people from their own faith that they deeply offended.
Yeah, and we have to move on to the
next
call.
Thank
you
very much, guys. Happy Mother's Day.
We have 3.5 minutes left in the show, so good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on WRCR, soon to be 1700 AM. Good morning. Oh, they're not there.
Is it me?
Yes, you're on the air.
I'm sorry, I wasn't sure it was me. Unfortunately, I have very short time, but two things. Number one is, I take offense to what Mr. Weider said, and I'll tell you why. Because there are no outsiders in this situation. Whether you live in the East Ramapo District, or you live outside the East Ramapo District in Buffalo, your tax dollars are still being distributed around this state to provide the educational and support services that the students get. No, the money from East Ramapo doesn't come back to East Ramapo. It's divided. So there are no outsiders. And number two, the reality is that we don't provide the proper and best education for these children, as I've done as a Spring Valley High School graduate, then ultimately we, as whether inside or out, we will be providing the support services that these individuals will need because they're not going to be able to get a good job and provide for their families and have the benefits that they need. So there are no outsiders in this game. We're all insiders, and we all really should be focusing on providing these kids with what they need best, equipping them to walk out into the world and get jobs. And that's really what it's about, providing them the tools to be good citizens and to be good parents and to be good part of the workforce. And thank you for what you guys do. You're great.
Thank you. Thanks for calling.
Thank you.
Happy Mother's Day.
And we can't take any more calls. We've got about a minute and a half left in the show. And we would like to thank all the mothers out there because it is Mother's Day coming up this Sunday.
Yep. And should we just also reinforce again, please come out to vote for the public school candidates on May 19th.
Yes, from 7 a.m. to 10 p.m., East Ramapo is unique, as you are well aware. And there was a caller who called up and wanted to know how to contact us. And if you want to privately email us, you can email us at eastrampounderground@hotmail.com. And I am the only one that accesses that account. So you'll get a private response back from me. And it's a way that we do get information on that Hotmail account.
That's right. That's right. Okay, so I think
we got 30 seconds left to go on the show. So we'd like to thank everybody again for calling in and listening. And happy
we'll
Mother's
see
Day.
See you next month.
on WRCR 1700 AM. And Who Wants to Be a Volunteer is next on this radio station.
Thank you.
Up in the morning and out to school. The teacher is teaching the golden rule. American history and practical math.
WRCR, Spring Valley, it's 11 o'clock.